Good, good. So, diversity. The first thing I do when researching something, I Google for Google Images, because that gives kind of overview of what humanity thinks that diversity is. And this is a stock photo, of course, and apparently this is diversity. So you see people with different skin color, you see men, you see women. So maybe some of them are gay, I don't know. But in total, this is what is diversity. But if you kind of zoom in, because I like the concept of stock photos, the title of that stock photo is Business Groups Showing Diversity in a Meeting. It's a piece of art. But if you look closer, there's actually a lot going on that's not all that diverse. First of all, they're all kind of too happy to be there, right? There is a bit, that meeting is not that much fun. First of all, they're all good-looking people, they're all happy, there are no sad or ugly people in stock photo land. Also, they wear exactly the same things, right? They don't have anything distinctive, they don't have a weird haircut, they don't have a tattoo or a piercing or something. So apparently diversity doesn't go that far, right? Because generally when we think about diversity, when we argue what its benefits are, it's usually people who think differently, who express themselves differently, have a different point of view. But apparently this diversity is just being slightly different colors. So, but apart from this aspect of diversity, diversity isn't free. I mean, it takes work. First of all, this slide is very dark, but even on a conference like this, where we welcome everybody, we do exclude everybody who doesn't speak English, basically, right? But that's just the way it is. I mean, humans can learn generally a handful of language, and even then it's a lot of work. But apart from that communication problem, there's also a more subtle one, that if you have people with different backgrounds talking together, it's actually harder to communicate because you have more misunderstandings. It's actually a lot easier to communicate with people who have the same background. And if you use words like design, performance, beauty, it actually has a lot of different meanings. But if you have different backgrounds, that's a problem. But if you don't, it's a lot easier. So that is a thing to take into consideration. We are here on the software conference, and I'm not going to do a soft talk, so let's talk about software. For diversity, I would like to do a thought experiment. Suppose I want to make an application. Yeah, I want to make a nice application, and I think .NET is a great platform, and Java is a great platform. So if I combine the two, I do one half in one and one half in the other, it will be amazing. Yeah, so maybe not, right? We all feel how bad that would be. But so let's take another experiment. So I want to make a data model for something. So two amazingly good databases. Let's do one half in this one, one half in Postgres. And it must be amazing, right? You can do the stuff that MySQL does better in one side, Postgres the other. Well, still, you know that it's not going to be all sunshine and roses. So that's not going to work. So apparently, we don't love diversity that much. Yeah. Also, there's a different kind of diversity, and I call that diversity as well, is that over time, software gets, yeah, it gets kind of dirty, it gets kind of old, and you look at it and you that's so 2012. And then we really want to throw it away, rewrite it so it's nice and clean again, even if it works perfectly fine, right? So we really strive for that consistency. And that has a reason, that didn't come out of nowhere. I think, it's my personal theory, that it's from engineering in general, that if you have two things that don't fit exactly together, it's useless. Especially with an Allen bolt, if you have a size 6 here and a size 7 here, it's completely useless. Well, your regular screwdriver, you might be able to jam it in somehow, but this is not going to work. And that's the reality with engineering. It has to be work together perfectly or not at all. So if we get back to our .NET example, actually Java and .NET are conceptually not that different, but the problems you'll get by trying to use them together are just as huge, right? So the problems of diversity are right in your face from moment one, and the upsides maybe one day, but you never know. So that can be tricky. So it looks like what we really want is monoculture. I mean, you want to have reproducible builds, you want to have a lot of the same things, you can be exactly sure that they're exactly the same. So that's an... So to us, monoculture is equal to clean, and diversity equals kind of messy. It's not necessarily bad, but it makes you want to take a shower. So, but today, as I am really into exotic hipster databases, I want to invite you to embrace diversity in databases just for this half hour, perhaps. And my name is Frank Lyaruu. I'm one of the people who have their last name as a Twitter handle. Can create some friction in your family, though. But I'm CTO at Dexels, a small company in Amsterdam. We do all kinds of services. We get back to that later. But going back to the diversity, what we need to do here is look at how can we lower the cost of diversity. So we can still use diverse technologies, but without the horrible .NET Java thing, because we all feel that it will be horrible. So how can we reduce that? Actually, the standard answer to any of those kind of questions is always, well, you had to split it up and you have to put them in separate boxes, right? And then you always end up with microservices. I'm not going to insult you all by explaining microservices, but in my context now, what I mean is that we would split them up, we would put some API in between, and without going into further detail, like this, it's still not great, right? It's not like, yeah, let's do this, but it could work. And actually, you might end up in this situation after a merger or something. Two companies go together. You have to somehow make this work together. So that's a common occurrence. But actually, what usually will happen is that we engineers will think, well, this is horrible. Let's just find the smallest part and just rewrite that one, and just make sure it's monoculture again. Yeah. So, but in microservices, this is feasible. It makes the polyglot applications possible. And so that has been going on for the last few years, and that seems to work. So, but if we want to extend that to databases, we have some extra challenges. Let's dig in. So we have a microservice here, we have some kind of code, and we have some kind of data store, and we have some kind of API. Yeah, so at this point, yeah, so we can do whatever we want. So this actually means that we can use any database we want in a microservice, because that's what it says, private. So yeah, mission accomplished, right? But not really, right? Because there is an aspect that most microservice examples all kind of avoid. It's never really denied, but it's kind of avoided, that you do need to share data. There is, if you have a few services, there is always a bit of data that most of them need, or all of them. And they might not have the same way of using it, but they do need to share it. And that doesn't quite fit into the microservice, the classic microservice structure. So if we assume this one, we have an application in some language, we have a database, and we have some analytics code. Just fake, but something. We have an UI for the user and we have an analytics UI. Fair enough, there are millions of these applications out there. So suppose we want to split this into two microservices. We can do something like this. We have our application and we have analytics UI, analytics. And now, for example, what we know that if we used analytics, it won't drag down our core database. Makes sense, right? So if you look at this picture, why not? But there is, it was easy. But there is a little bit more to it because an analytics API. What does that even mean? Yeah. So how would that work, an analytics API? Would it, because like analytics uses pretty much all the data or a lot of it at least. So you have a REST call that downloads the whole database. I guess in some situations it can work, but it doesn't really feel right. You can have like get some IDs first and then download them individually, but it's still not really working because the analytic just wants to access to the data. So maybe we can do something like this. We have a REST API and we just pass on the query. I guess it can work, but it's cheating. So we can't really do that because we basically are ignoring the fact that in a microservice the data store is supposed to be private. And if we have SQL in our query, in our API calls, it's not exactly private. So that's not going to work. Besides, you can still kill your original database this way. Yeah, so the thing we set out to do is still unsolved. So we have some possibilities there over the years. We have some replication tools like the Golden Gate, SharePlex, dbvisit, who can just take one database, listen to it, and replicate in another database. So you could do that. It should work, but it does break the microservice model a little bit because there's not really supposed to be magic. Yeah, and it's also there like horribly expensive. So, as I said, the data stores are tightly coupled, so it's not really a microservice anymore. And we can't use cool databases because then we have to wait until SharePlex supports them, so that's not going to be anytime soon. And as our number of services grows, this is going to be horrible. We can kind of feel that. So for that, we have event-driven microservices. They are different than the classic microservices. There are classic microservices, and what you do there is that instead of requesting, like in a REST kind of way, requesting data, getting an answer between services, they just post things that happened. They just shout into the air like this happened, and usually it's backed up by some public publish subscribe bus. Looks something like this: we have an application service, some language, we have a SQL database, we have some code that will listen to the change in the database and make a nice message of it, and throw it into the event bus. And you address it using a topic. You just shout it out. And the application service is not aware at all that there's an analytics listening on the other side. The analytic listens to the event bus, it sees all the changes, and by putting all those changes back into a database, it has an analytics store. And it can use any shape you want. But so for that event bus, we're going to use Kafka today. Actually, I had some more Kafka, but there was so much Kafka yesterday that I kind of slimmed it down. But for now, kind of PubSub persistent message bus. You can throw a lot of stuff through it. Important is that subscribers can be behind, and that's okay for the bus. For some other buses, it's a problem if some are fast and some are slow. And you can request a rewind so that it will re-emit the same topic again. And that's also important because that gives you the ability to rebuild your database if it's necessary. So one of our clients, Sportlink, It's a service provider for team sports in the Netherlands. It's not exactly a greenfield application. It's over 10 years old. We manage personal data, competition planning, assigning officials, the lot. It's not small. There are over a million players. There are 4,000 clubs, 40,000 matches a week. It keeps amazing that number. It has a very spiky load because, like, Saturday morning at 11, there are lots of small children kicking a ball somewhere, and some other times it's really quiet, but it's predictable. So right now, the technology stack we had until now was basically an Oracle database, a cluster of Java application servers, and a lot of different clients talking to that system. Now we have a challenge because we want to move from a more, usually the clubs did all the stuff, so all the mutation, planning the matches and everything, but we want to move to a more player-centric, so all the players do stuff. And that goes from the 4,000 clubs to the 1 million players. That's an order of magnitude more load. We can't really move away from Oracle in the short term. Also, we can't afford to scale Oracle to do that. It's just too expensive. So for us, being diverse in databases is no joke. We just need to do something. So what we did, we have our core service. Basically, the way it was, we listened to the changes. We put it to the Kafka bus. We have a secondary service that will serve the consumers. It uses a MongoDB databases. It absorbs all the changes and put it into a big MongoDB database. And now this can take all most of the hits, and the Oracle just only handles writes. So that is kind of working, but there is still something missing, because if I go back to the previous slide, if we have a relational database there, and we have a document database there. And if you use a relational data model and you copy it one-on-one on the document database, it's not going to be magically great. Because basically what you have done is taking a relational model that's all about doing joins into a database that doesn't do joins. So that's not really an improvement. But that was a bit of a misconception there, but it is fixable. So this is what I meant with for example, you have telephone numbers and persons. You have multiple telephone numbers per person. You can query them like this and group them together and then do whatever you want with it. In MongoDB, you wouldn't do that like that. You wouldn't have separate collections there. You would want to have like a single document that has all the stuff you need in there. And if you need more things, you just put it in the document and you have just one single query. Yeah, so that's a difference. So we need to bridge that. We need to get from the SQL records, which basically need to be joined, into the MongoDB database. And actually that sounds a lot easier than it is. If you do like a stateless transformation, you want to do a rename from a field or something, that's easy. But actually, if you think about it, if you want to do this, you end up needing to store everything in the streaming layer. Because we use Kafka Streams here. Kafka Streams uses RocksDB, but conceptually, all the person records are here, for example, and all the phone numbers are here. The first person might have the last phone number, right? We don't know that. So we just need to store everything in our local RocksDB. It's like an in-process data store. We just store everything, and when we have a match in something, we insert it into MongoDB. But this is a big beast. And this is just only one join. So in the end, like, this one is so much bigger than the MongoDB we end up with. So all in all, we started at about 500 million of rows of SQL data, but we have like 50 joins, 200 topics, but like the Kafka, the RocksDB and the Kafka are like really a lot of data. The eventual MongoDBs are only a few. So building up this beast takes many, many hours. And after that, when it's built, then the changes progress pretty quickly. But this is an expensive operation. Also, what is has been very educational for me, if you are developing and debugging streaming code, it's different than if you're debugging stateless code. If you just, with stateless code, you can just edit and you just basically press F5 and you see if it's what you want. But that doesn't work for a stream application. I can stop and start it with new code, but then I have like a semi, have a system that ran on one code and then I change it and then what does that mean? I mean, sometimes you can get away with it, but you never really know. But again, if I have to start a whole new thing all over again, and it runs for 24 hours before I know that that join wasn't really right, so it's a really difficult. It takes getting used to this flow. Also, we found a lot of weird data in a database that has been sitting there for years and was never a problem. For example, if we compare it with the issue we had before, suppose if one person has 10,000 phone numbers by some strange reason that happens at some point, that poor streaming thing will start try to mesh all those phone numbers together into one bigger and bigger and bigger Mongo document. So at some point it has like 500 phone numbers, it stores it in RocksDB, then another one shows up, it gets the 500 out of RocksDB, it adds one, puts it back, so the whole system kind of dies. And you have no idea why, because there are no errors, it's just slowly bleeding out. So those things that happened. We had a soccer match that started in the year 72 after Christ and had an attached document for every day since. And somehow, no, if you would look in the old system at that match, the system would go crazy for a few seconds and then it would be okay. But nobody cared, it was a match, it was years ago, so we never noticed. But once we started doing this, yeah, that was a problem. So that's some of the things we learned. So this part went into production early June. It generally behaves, and actually I was submitting this talk before I had any clue if it was going to work or not, so I'm glad it did. Kafka Streams was pretty rough when we started with it. It's still we run into bugs from time to time, but it's so much better now, so I'm really thankful for that. But this is not the end, because we were actually here talking about database diversity. We kind of made a detour. So now we can have some fun with that, because now we can think about what kind of databases can we plug in. Yeah. So let's first of all, what we can do now, for example, Elasticsearch. We can add unstructured search to our application. We have like, our application is 10 years old, so it has like a really structured kind of search thing that you can search on a certain name or phone number or whatever, and it makes no sense. People just want to put in some search terms and then it should cough up something kind of relevant. And that's a lot easier now, because we can just put this in Elasticsearch and we can take off the load of all the searching from our primary database. And we can just try this, we can run it in production without anybody noticing, so because we just listen to the same topics, build it up, and if it completely sucks, well, then you throw it away. You have a lot less interference between the parts. So Elasticsearch is a classic one. One I like a lot is Neo4j. Anyone know it? Yes, okay, good. Are there any Neo4j real committers people here? They're a little bit weird, but they have a different view on the world. They see graphs everywhere. and that's actually funny, because if you talk to them for a while, you start to see graphs anywhere, everywhere as well. I'm not really sure if that's the way to look at the world, but it is interesting. Because some problems are so much easier if you reframe your data as a graph. There are some examples around for doing some analytics on some relational model that's like, I kid you not, a full page of SQL to make it happen, and like it runs for half an hour. And if you look at the cipher query of Neo4j, it's completely obvious what it does, and it's like five lines. Because you just traverse in a graph, you think, okay, what do I need to do? I start here, which nodes do I follow? And it's very helpful to work with it, but you would never replace your existing database by something for Neo4j. That will be a hugely invasive operation. But if you can just plug it in, get used to it and see its benefits, it can be very, very useful. And even if you end up not using it, realizing the different views that exist on a database is very helpful. Another one I want to look at, Firebase Real-Time. Anybody use it? It's actually barely a database, but it's acquired by Google now. And it's a real-time database, but it models its data as a big one JSON document. That's your data. It's like a JSON document in the sky, and they host it. It's completely transparent for the rest. But you can, in a web or in a mobile application, you can subscribe to a piece of that tree, of that JSON tree, and you think, okay, I want this value to be here. And then the connector to the database will keep it in sync as it changes. So if we connect this to our Kafka Streams API, then we have basically a part of the data in the sky with Firebase, and then you can connect anything to it. And if you look at some of the really basic examples of Firebase are actually really useful applications if you can get the data in there, because no way you're going to use this as a real database. But if for a specialized job, it's amazingly powerful and amazingly easy to use. And I think that's a important thing to think about. Just the fact that it can't do a lot of things makes it powerful in its own right, because it's easier to use. But while we are slowly relaxing the definition of what a database is, we can also use this to push through caches, right? Because we know when stuff changes, we can invalidate caches when it's necessary. We don't need to expire it anymore. But while we're at it, we can also like push it straight to clients. If we know that some person on the phone is looking at a piece of data, and our system detects that that data changed, we can just take the data, shove it through the WebSocket or something, and update in place. So that's some stuff we're looking into. I don't know if it will ever happen, but that's a bit on my to-do list. I ignored quite a few things, mostly because there was so much Kafka yesterday. There is one important part is how do you listen to a database for all the changes, because that sounds like a conceptually logical thing that should always be there, and it isn't. There is so much work to do to get that to work. Martin Kleppmann had right here a very nice talk about it 2 years ago. It's really good, and that covers exactly that part. Also, eventual consistency, because this system is eventually consistent. And that is no joke. It makes a whole lot of stuff a lot harder, because, for example, you change something and all the databases will update, but when? You can say, well, it's usually 100 milliseconds, I just pause for a second and then it should be done. And most of the time it is, but you never really know. So to get over that, you really need to rephrase on how you want to deal with it. If you can, the best way would it to actually push the changes, right? To never query data, just to register to listen to updates. But you can't always do that. So there is a lot of work there. All the Kafka compaction and partitioning, but I think there will be other talks about that. For the rest, I want to add one more thing, and that's databases are people. it is obviously nonsense, but there is something in it, right? Because especially the specialized databases, they tell something about how the person writing the database is thinking. How do they look at the problem space? And I have learned a lot by just trying to solve problems with different databases, because it's like having a teammate with a different background. It does help. You do get to know people by the software they write. I strongly believe that. So I do think the diversity in database and in people are kind of related in a sort of hand wavy way. So yeah, so even if you don't end up using a lot of different databases, I think it's very useful and educational to fool around with them a little bit. So thank you for embracing database with me for a little bit. Any questions?
How did you solve the problem with the delivery guarantee for delivering exactly once?
You mean the way we deal with it mostly is that as we have IDs for everything, we can, it's idempotent. It's okay if it's more than once. So we actually accept it. Don't fight it. We had somebody there.
Thanks a lot for the talk. I have a question about the denormalization after the SQL database. Mm-hmm. So when Martin Kleppmann gave his talk on the bottled water plugin, he did exactly that thing for one table. One table would always translate into one topic. And I think the problem you're having with the denormalization, many people have that same problem. I was wondering if you've considered other approaches, like, for instance, creating some kind of thin app that would do the denormalization closer to the database by doing little queries, producing your document in the end and pushing that into the topic.
Yeah, maybe. At that moment, we really needed something that kind of worked, and Kafka Streams was kind of on the bleeding edge, but I thought it could work, and it did. But there is a complexity there and a weight there that's you can't hide from that. It has to be somewhere. And lately, there's a bit of a surge of the multi-model database, like Cosmos DB and Microsoft released a few weeks ago. And that's basically also the database diversity, but you draw a box around it and you give it a name, basically. And that would work as well. But if you have an application that's there and you need to add stuff to it, it has to be as non-invasive as possible. But no, yeah, we tried several things. This was the one we came up with, and it works. Right here.
Hi, thank you for the talk. It's not a technical question. In terms of change management, I guess you had a team working with Oracle and form to that. How did you manage to get them to these technologies?
Well, I mean, in Oracle, everything is possible with a price tag. I mean, all the change management is in Oracle. That's basically the Golden Gate extension. It goes straight to Kafka, and if you fork over an insane amount of money, that's done for you. It's there. But we couldn't afford it. So we just ended up using triggers on databases, on all the tables we needed. And on the triggers, we inserted into a log table, and we pulled the log table and inserted into Kafka. It's kind of roundabout, but and it's also not suited if you have a really crazy amount of writes. But we knew the number of writes we had, and we knew that the number of writes is not going to change much. It's not that after this there will be more matches necessarily. So we knew we could get away with this. And if your number of changes are not ridiculous, this will work. Good question. Anything else? Then thank you.
So thank you, Frank. Clap again for him.